A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this 90th episode of the Together for Education webinars brought to you by Notebook. Almost a year ago, on 20th April 2020, we were just a month into the pandemic. What seemed like a short duration pause in our education system has now turned out to be a year-long ordeal. And with this year's CBSE exams for class 10 cancelled, CBSE exams for class 12 postponed now, we are perhaps looking at a much longer haul. The Together for Education webinars were set up as a platform to help our esteemed educators get a more hands-on experience of this newfangled learning system, which involved the Zoom platform. Little did we know that a year later, we would be inviting people for our 90th episode. This platform has grown from strength to strength, thanks to your love and support. And for that, we are extremely grateful. Over these months, we have covered a number of topics. We have discussed extremely curriculum-oriented topics. We have discussed co-curricular and extracurricular topics. We have discussed topics of mental health. Today, we are going to look at something that is interesting, that is coveted, but sometimes very debatable: school rankings. A number of publications across the country publish school rankings across a number of parameters. Today, however, we are going to look at the importance, if at all, the goods and the bads of what the school ranking system entails. Our first speaker today is Mr. Philip Barrett. Mr. Barrett retired as the deputy headmaster from the illustrious Dhoon School in Dehradun after 44 years of serving in education across various institutions. He served the Dhoon School as housemaster, head of department, dean of activities, dean of student welfare, deputy headmaster, second master, and acting headmaster with great distinction. He also carried out a visioning exercise for the Dhoon School in the year 2011 through an in-depth study of a number of British public schools and various schools in the US. Mr. Barrett qualified as a leadership trainer at Wellington College, UK in the year 2000. He is also an athlete, an adventurer, and a naturalist. And we at Notebook are privileged to have him as a senior advisor. So, thank you so much for joining. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Subhayu, for that introduction. And a very good evening to the entire Notebook team, which includes Achin, you, Abhishek, Meghna, and so many others over there. A very good evening to our esteemed panelists, especially Mrs. Ghosh, who haven't met for so long, and all the good people who have tuned in, Mrs. Tiwari and Shabnam and everyone over there. So, you know, I've often wondered why students, let alone schools, need to be ranked. If education is all about a child having the freedom and resources to grow into where their hearts lead, and then why must we know whether he's second in class or 45th in class? Why must we rate ourselves against others? All we need to do is to improve. So even as the 97% student aspires to get 99, the 45% types aspire to get 50. And I think progress is more often important and left out, rather than where we stand with each other. To me, this reminds me of the SEAT cricket ratings, of course, which Subhayu would be very familiar with. I loved it because I could, I used to follow where Rahul Dravid lay as, one number one batsman, where India lay in the test rankings. Also, you have these bike and car rankings, the best car of the year and the super bike of the year in all these auto magazines. So, but somebody once said, if something cannot be measured, it cannot be improved. I agree. But is this measurement, is this ranking being done correctly? Are these ranking figures authentic? Are they based on first-hand information? Or are they based on some vague, long-ago impression based on stories one picks up at cocktail parties? So some years ago, rankings of schools and colleges and institutions were brought into, in my life, by the India Today magazine, where I looked at the top liberal arts colleges because my elder children were on the verge of getting into colleges. Again, these rankings came through the magazine called The Education World, which opened it up for schools. And I remember I was deputy headmaster at Dhoon at that stage, and I had to go to Delhi to receive some of these awards on behalf of the school. And once again, NDTV again called us to a five-star hotel where I received some awards on behalf of the school. And I remember these events with much amusement. because not only did the heads of so many schools get another social, yet another social function to meet, chat, organize inter-school events, while they sipped their tea and nibbled at their snacks, nobody seemed to take these events very seriously and engaged in chatter while the MC for the evening rattled on and on, till one's own school was called up for an award and the representatives rushed up, very much like the Oscars. There was a lot of flashing of cameras. They smiled, photographs were taken, and that was it. The school's marketing department, which I think would be very much more attracted to these things, used to come for these events. And I think apart from the networking that went on, the entire evening was rather a meaningless function. Many years before this, I had seen books in the UK where all the independent schools were ranked, and there was it's like an almanac, almost a catalog of schools, where they're located, how far from London, what their fees were, what their grounds were. And this sort of a whole independent schools booklet or a calendar, very, very thick, maybe 3 inches thick, were very good, because people these days shop for schools for their children like they shop for cars. So instead of going around to all the big Toyota, Nissan showrooms, they pick up a car magazine and the data is all there. Similarly, rankings help us avoiding, it saves us going to all the schools and helps us narrow down the list that we need to physically visit. But again, in Europe and the UK, there are also very stringent school inspections, and every school has to meet established standards, the boarding school standards of excellence in order to stay in business. It's like the ISI rankings of a school, or stamp of approval, like an ISO stamp or an FSSAI or an AGMARC or a WoolMark stamp. It gives a school that bit of prestige and a feather in its cap. Now, these tokens of excellence are, in my opinion, more valuable than rankings, as they make schools look at their own weaknesses and strengths. And these schools can seek to improve. And many of these schools would lose their rights to continue if they failed to meet up with these standards. They've also been given, after stringent inspections of the schools by a team of experienced inspectors. But in India, most rankings are carried out by companies specialized in doing these rankings. And these may be through online surveys, which are public perception surveys, actually, which cover about, between 8 and 18 parameters, ranging from faculty quality, alumni, facilities, professional development, internationalism, sporting achievements, results. And each survey may have a different set of parameters which are being judged, by which the school is being judged against. The Education World Rankings were done by a company called C4, with field workers interviewing thousands of fee-paying parents, alumni, principals, teachers, senior school students in almost 28 major cities and international hubs all over India. There was a part of the survey that was a hard survey that the schools themselves had to fill in, and send in. Also, all these ranking bodies, as they grew, there were so many new categories that were added on. Best residential school, best day school, best co-ed school, best hill school, best school in the state. Then you had the CBSE list, then the ISC list, then the international schools list. And the awards at these five-star functions, which I spoke of earlier, was so large that it often ran into hours and hours. And it seemed that every school in the country was given some award or the other. It was almost like an appeasement scheme. I wondered whether schools were manipulating these awards. I'm sure there were schools that were manipulating and doing things to get these awards. I know schools, even in Dehradun, who are rated as India's top schools, and I sincerely doubt how they were rated like that. Another school tucked away in a small street in Okhla was awarded the best school in UP, which had a population of 250 million. Again, I ask, how was this survey done? A funny story that I must relate is when the Dhoon School was rated one, it was given the first rank in residential schools in India. We invited the editor of India Today, Educational World, to come and see the school. We had said that you hadn't visited the school. How were these surveys carried out? Thank you very much for rating us number one, but do come into the school. So he came, he had lunch with us, he went around the grounds, and after having seen the whole school for the first time in his life, the next year, we were given the second position. It was very funny. And somebody else had to go to the five-star hotel to get these awards. But let's look at the advantages of these rankings and not scoff at them too much. The first thing is that schools get known. There's an increase in visibility. They get onto the radar. It's a great form of advertisements. And surely it must help in recruiting better students. It helps in admissions. The other thing is that colleges get to know schools. And when schools are high in the ranking, colleges tend to go for students from these schools because they want the best students. Schools attract students through ranking. And often students would leave a school to move to a more highly rated school because they believe that the academic program and their sports program are better, or they offer a rather larger choice on the buffet of activities. Rankings also attract the best faculties because teachers love to move upwards. They love to move from one school to the other, improving themselves and building that CV. I've seen it at interviews with teachers. And teachers don't stay in one place unless they're really happy. Also, the school gets to know what it is good at and what it was ranked highly for and what it was not ranked highly for. For example, the Dhoon was ranked very highly for internationalism, alumni strength, community service, and adventure. But we were not ranked very highly for other things, which we began to work at. So while we were very proud of some parameters, which became the USP of the school, we had to work at some of our weak points. Also, schools can get to know their competition and try to be good at things other than what the competitions offer. Schools in a certain area vie for admission. So they try and be good at things that other schools are not good at. Now, it also helps to be competitive and self-critical, as schools do after they get ranked. It also leads to a sense of pride and culture. It builds a school culture. It builds tradition in schools. I would say that if a school was ranked very highly in, let's say, sporting achievements, that would become the pride of the children, and they would make sure that in the next year's ranking, this wouldn't fall. But there are certain disadvantages in rankings. First of all, in the way it's done, it's very perceptive. The question arises, do these people really know the schools? Have they really visited the schools? The second would be, are they manipulated? All heads and owners of schools know that a high ranking would really put them on the spotlight. And so I don't see why people wouldn't get involved in handling these rankings. The other thing is the parameters covered and surveyed often leave out the real picture. For example, some students, like happiness, student happiness, or the pastoral care are very difficult to access or to assess by a team, especially in a perceptive survey. What happens in the houses when the lights go off? It's very hard to assess. A school may have fancy buildings and, CC cameras, but are the children happy? It is easy to look at the facilities of top international schools and give them a 9 on 10 rating. And a poor school down the road gets 2 on 10 because of the facilities. But students may be far happier and less bullied in the second school than in the first mentioned school, where you're paying about 10 times the salary, the fees. But the other thing is that students tend to move around. And even if a few good students move from a highly rated school to a poorly ranked school, it could reshuffle or readjust the rankings. And these things go unnoticed by a ranking system. Apart from boosting the management's ego and helping parents narrow down their search for a school, as I mentioned earlier, it also exposes schools to the college admission officers. And once a school is highly ranked, especially for the US and UK and European colleges, they tend to know that this school is worth going for. In fact, many parents have now, they are quite tired of looking at ranking because they are quite sick and tired of the facilities and swimming pools and the air-conditioned this and the air-conditioned that. What they really want to know is, what is the quality of the teaching? Are the children going to be happy and safe? And sometimes rankings leave out these points. And actually, only the middle class in this country is transferable. You know, if you have a government job, they put a lot of stress on educating their children. These people would take ranking seriously. If you're very poor, you have no choice but to go for the nearest and cheapest available school. Or if you're very rich, you just know the 2 to 3 schools in India that you want to look for. Or probably you look for schools abroad. And, you know, the 0.00001% of people who send their kids abroad wouldn't look at rankings in India. And they would know the schools they want to go to. Rankings also encourage schools to rest on their laurels and stop growing. Once they've had some sort of admission momentum, they settle down to, you know, we do things this way and will not change attitude. You know, they lack the growth mindset. In other words, it leads to a false sense of pride and encourages elitism sometimes. Once you're highly rated, you become elitist. Colleges have realized that once a school is able to attract the best brains, all other things will follow, like better college placements, better and more successful alumni, better teachers, better sports results. So it is not the school that does it, it's the students that are there. If you get the best students in, everything else will follow. They will be better alumni, they will be better college placements. Teacher retention is another thing. Because as I said earlier, teachers move from school to school, but once they get to a school that is happy and, you know, is highly rated, they stay. Sometimes rankings tend to miss out on things like size of class, teacher-student ratios, scholarship and funding. Does the school give funding to lesser advantaged children? What about discipline? Very difficult thing to assess in an online survey. Would parents change schools if they could afford the fees? What about students' attitude and parochialism? These are a number of immeasurables that affect students' life and happiness, but which cannot be seen on a survey. And with that, I think I will now bring this to an end, Shubhayu. I look forward to hearing from Achin and our esteemed panelists. Thank you very much, and over to you.
Thank you so much, sir. When we were deciding on this topic, given the phenomenal institutes that we've worked with, we were very curious to know which side of the line you would be on, whether you would be pro-rankings or anti-rankings. And I think this was a very, very balanced introduction to the whole topic that sets the tone for the evening. Thank you. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, our next speaker is Achin Bhattacharya. Achin is the founder and CEO at Notebook. A chartered accountant by training, Achin was a director at Deloitte prior to starting Notebook. He has worked in India and abroad in various senior capacities in GE, PwC, KPMG, and Deloitte. He is a fellow of the ICAI and a member of CP Australia. He's also the recipient of the prestigious Indian Achievers Award. Achin is an avid reader and a passionate traveler with keen interests in economics, history, literature, and philosophy. He is a regular speaker at various forums and chambers of commerce and also contributes articles to numerous publications regularly. He is also on the board for some of the most renowned corporates and contribute significantly to their brand strategies. Achin, over to you.
Good evening, everyone. Shubha, am I audible?
Yeah, Achin, loud and clear.
I once again welcome all of you to today's session on a topic which is not only important for all stakeholders of the educational ecosystem, from their own individual sectoral perspectives, like as parents, educators, students, but also needs a collective self-introspection as a society as to how and why qualitative and intangible factors can be quantified and compared to arrive at a universally acceptable consensus. And for the sake of argument, even if we manage to do that in some form and fashion, how free and fair that analysis can be. The other day, I was listening to a very interesting TED Talk, which I wanted to share with all of you, by Hiroshi Ono, a Japanese gentleman, an engineer turned sociologist turned researcher in Japan. And he shared a very insightful experience of his own as a fresh engineering graduate many decades back, when he went to a job fair for fresh engineering graduates. And all graduates were asked to drop their resumes. Now, what he shares next is indeed shocking. He said that in that particular hall, just before I entered the job fair, there are four different boxes of four different colors. And the first box mentioned only for students of Tokyo University. The second box mentioned Hito Tsubai University. The third, Waseda and Kyo. And the fourth, others. So first three that I mentioned are among the most premier universities in Japan. So very clearly, this demonstrates the preconceived notion on the part of employers who are a part of the larger civil society, and explicit and, blatant. It's not subtle, it's explicit and blatant with regard to the fact that, going by their opinion, the quality of graduates depends upon only one criteria, and that is the university from where they have passed out. And I may have discussed about a case from Japan, but we all know that it exists in every country. So when we discuss about US, the Harvards and the Princetons, Ivy Leagues, Chicago, MIT, Stanford. When we discuss about UK, Oxford, Cambridge, and the same everywhere. Now, this leads to hyper-competitive admission process in these institutions, as if that's the only determining factor for the student's future, as if that's the end of the road. But practical experience shows that may not be the case. Of course, a great institution of repute, which has built its legacy and reputation over the years, undoubtedly, that's a commendable feat. That's an example, that's an inspiration for many others to follow. But the question is that a make or break? Is that the end of the road? And the answer probably is no. Now, research tells us, and when I discuss about research, decades of research, and as esteemed educators, I'm sure all of you would agree with me, that the single most important school-related factor, so when we discuss about a school, it's not about the height of building, it's not about state-of-the-art infra. Of course, these are important. But the most important thing which affects a student's success is the quality of his or her teacher. Particularly in a child's early years. Now, essentially, these rankings tells us much more about who goes to these top schools and not necessarily what the student gets out of them. Now, rankings, when we decide rankings, as Bharat also mentioned, so there are a huge number of factors that contribute to it, right? And none of these rankings can give a comprehensive overview of the strengths of these institutions, simply because they are ranked based on a range of easily quantifiable characteristics which can be quantified, as I told you, but not necessarily everything in life can be quantified. Not necessarily every intangible factor can be accurately measured and quantified. So rankings are very often, which are conducted by magazines, newspapers, websites. Now, so they basically try to combine a host of factors, various factors, right? And these might not be the only factors which matter. There might be a host of other factors as well, as I think sir very appropriately mentioned, that how happy the student is, what is the learning outcome? I think that is most important. How is the student-teacher bonding? How much of an extra effort are the educators giving? Is the student engaged enough? Is the student happy every day in the morning going to his or her school? So how do we quantify these factors? How do we get these factors on an Excel sheet and rank them? Next to impossible. Again, with regard to these rankings, there have been various debates across the world, and not only with regard to school rankings, even with regard to rankings for higher institutions, etc. With regard to school rankings, of course, we have so many esteemed educators today in our panel, a great panel, I must say, and I'm sure they'll share their own individual perspective. But if I look at it from a more holistic perspective, so I completely agree that it very clearly says that when we look at rankings, especially, for example, and there's been a debate in UNESCO as well with regard to uses and misuses of rankings, especially, say, for example, for higher institutions. So these international rankings at times, this gave rise to tremendous amount of competition. Now, and so many stakeholders, students, policymakers, parents, so many stakeholders being involved in this. And so much of recommendations also coming from this. But one thing is very clear, and again, it has been proved that there are two different approaches when we look at it. One is ranking and the other is benchmarking. So undoubtedly, benchmarking is very important. With regard to rankings, I have my reservations. But with regard to benchmarking, with regard to some eminent institutions setting up high standards, acting as lighthouses, acting as source of inspiration, acting as examples, acting as point of reference for others to follow, is a wonderful thing. So it basically transforms organizational processes into strategic tools and helps other institutions compare their own practice and performance with their more esteemed peers. So benchmarking can either be internal, say between two departments, competitive, collaborative. Again, you know, I think wonderful approach, sharing of best practices. Wherein an esteemed institution actually helps others to come up the learning curve. Something that the cluster concept that even NEP 2020 has advocated. The shadow concept, that is making competitor to competitor comparisons without the partner knowing, and also best in class practices, sharing them. So again, going by practical experience, what we see, various factors which are often, you know, which often come when it comes to ranking, and very important factor, goodwill and legacy, I think single most important factor. Learning experience, academic result. But I think in modern world, there are two more factors which we see strongly coming in next few decades. So first and foremost, definitely infrastructure. So when we say infra, there's a completely different perspective to infrastructure that has come in, especially during last 1 year, during this pandemic. Online infrastructure is going to come in a big way. Online presence, how strong and robust the learning platforms are, how conversant the educators and students are. And second, I think another very important perspective when it comes to ranking, as I was telling you, that it's not only about buildings or infra. I think very importantly, it's also about people, and more importantly about people, educators, school management, school staff. And at times, you know, if when it comes to transformational leadership, at times, and history has proved this again and again, that a great leader can really make an institution count. And I would like to cite one example in this particular regard. An example, of course, not from the academic world, but from the corporate world, but very relevant example. So when I started my deliberation a few minutes back, I started with an example from Japan. So I'd like to end as well with an example from Japan. And wonderful example, one of the most renowned ones. So this is with regard to how transformational leadership can actually ensure that an organization without asking for external help, without getting in, you know, without trying to change its entire culture, or without trying to change its entire people or getting more resources, can actually turn around because of visionary leadership and because of transformation leadership, and what effect it has on ranking, since we were discussing about ranking today. So I'd like to discuss a case study, a very simple one, about Japan Airlines. Now, many of you will be aware that Japan Airlines in 1980s was the number one in the world. For 5 years in a row, they were rated as the best airline in the world, 1980s. 5 years in a row, best airline in the world. From middle of 1980s till 2000, they had a very rough patch. Lot of wrong strategic decisions, wrong acquisitions, cost overruns, and the organization started going down. So much so that in 1987, they were privatized, that's the first part, and they started going down so much so that by 2010 beginning, they had filed for bankruptcy. So an organization which was leading the world in the 80s, filing for bankruptcy by beginning of 2010. And then the government decided that let's give it another shot. That point of time, in February 2010, they got in a retired gentleman, a very senior and respected gentleman in Japan, Mr. Inamori, an entrepreneur who had earlier very successfully started and run a business called Kyocera. Very successful business, Kyocera. So Mr. Inamori was brought in with a single task, that can you turn this airline around? Because Japan Airlines was always looked at as the pride of Japan. And the entire nation was disappointed that this airline is going down. So he was tasked with this one single task. Can you turn this around? He took over in February 2010. And to give a background, that he was not only a very successful retired entrepreneur and a billionaire, he was also a scientist. So as a scientist, he had a very, very analytical approach to things, very systematic approach to things. And a priest, a Buddhist priest. So a very spiritual thought process. And he was brought in that, can you actually turn this around for us? As a nation, we want you to do this for us, for our next generations. We want them to be proud of our national career. So he was brought in. Without taking any external debt, without asking for any external help, he was able to motivate the employees to such extent that in 2 years, he turned the organization around. And in 2012, Japan Airlines was again ranked as the number one airline in the world within 2 years. And they not only met their revenue targets, but they exceeded their revenue targets by 5 times. So if they're asked to make 100, so their top line ended up as 500. And not only that, they went forward with a public offering in Tokyo Stock Exchange, which was the second highest in that particular year, only second after Facebook. So you can imagine how one person can turn an organization around. And what did he do? What was the magic? The only magic he did is he believed in his staff. He had faith in his colleagues. He empowered them. He told them that I trust you. This is your company. And I'm here to save your job. I'm not here for a salary. I'm not taking a single rupees from this company. I'm here to save your job. I'm here to ensure that customers, they get a fair deal. When they try to buy a ticket, they should have an option. Otherwise, this airline will close down. So only thing that I'm asking you to do is take ownership for your job. Try to bring costs down, try to get revenues up. And don't work to please your boss, work for your organization. That was one single message and he turned it around. So coming to ranking, so whenever we discuss the term ranking, this is one of the most famous case studies in any B-school around the world. That is always discussed, that how one single person can turn around ranking in such a competitive industry. So with this, I think there are a few things that I wanted to share. We are a very esteemed panel today. And I really look forward to their deliberation in this important topic. I thank all of you for giving me a patient hearing. Over to you, Shubhai.
Thank you, Ajit. Thank you for the wonderful presentation. And I think that Japan Airlines case study is something that everybody will take home with them. Ladies and gentlemen, as Ajit mentioned, we do have a stellar panel lined up for you today. Before we go on to that, just a few things about Notebook. We at Notebook are an edtech organization. We make short videos pertaining to the school curriculum. We cover all subjects, right from classes 1 through to class 12 of CBSE. Now, these videos are useful in two different ways. First, you as educators have access to these videos when you're taking your class, be it an online class or an offline one. You can play these videos as an introduction to the topic, or you can ask the students to watch these videos before they come for your class, which basically raises their curiosity levels and give them a visual understanding of the topic that you're about to teach. Months later, when these students have to write an exam, they have access to the same videos from their personal devices, be it a laptop or a smartphone. They can watch these videos from home and prepare for their exams. Not only does it give them a quick visual way to revise the topic, it also reminds them of what exactly you had taught in class the day the video was played. What I'm going to do now is play a short sample of one of the Notebook videos, and then we can move on to the panel discussion.
This is the beautiful town of Kannauj during the medieval period. And this is Inayat and Nuri. They have their workshop right next to their home where many people work. Heaps of flowers, herbs, spices, camel skin bottles, and the air is filled with a cocktail of wonderful fragrances. Guess what is going on, students? Yes, we are inside the distillery and they are all into the production of perfumes. Hello and welcome to this another new lesson series of business studies on the chapter Internal Trade. Now, students, quickly have a look at the cities marked on this map of ancient India and guess why we have marked them out. Vaishali, Vidisha, Ujjaini, Paithan, Surat, Lothal, Broach, Kalyan, Mahabalipuram, Arikamedu, Madurai. Guess why have we marked out the cities? Yes, all these cities were important trade centers in ancient India. There were interconnected road and river routes intelligently developed to accelerate since the olden days. Now, let's come back to Kannauj once again. All the different perfumes produced are not only sold in different parts of India, but also to different parts of the globe. When the perfumes are sold inside our own country, it is called internal trade.
Well, this was a short sample of one of the notebook videos. You would find more than 10,000 such videos at your disposal when you're taking your class using notebook. I would invite you all to visit our website, www.notebook.school, to check out our work. Well, with that done, it is now time to move on to the discussion at hand. As we've been telling you, we do have a stellar panel lined up for you today. I will take just a couple of minutes to introduce them and then start the discussion. We are privileged to have with us Mrs. Brinda Ghosh, who is the principal of the Gyan Shri School in Noida. Mrs. Ghosh is an accomplished educationist who holds a diploma in teaching and training from Cambridge University, besides a post-graduation degree in English literature. As an academician, she has had a wide experience on the prevalent boards and has taught and been in leadership positions in some of the best schools of the country, like Vikasa School Madurai, Wellham Girls Dehradun, and Yadvinder Public School Patiala. She also has the unique distinction of being the founder principal of two leading schools in India. Mrs. Ghosh is an instructional leader and a teacher's trainer, believes in giving intensive training and opportunities for professional growth to her staff to bring about a progressive edge to pedagogical methods in and outside the classroom. She has conducted workshops at various institutions to train teachers, students, and parents, and has thereby been able to pass on her penchant for being abreast with the latest trends in education and parenting. She has traveled to the Queensland University of Australia, Yale, an American private Ivy League research university, Jakarta, Indonesia, Berlin in Germany, and Lahore in Pakistan as a trainer and teacher. A gold awardee of IAYP, Mrs. Ghosh encourages students to strike a balance between academics and sports. A voracious reader, she dabbles with writing and has written for several educational journals and has authored two books. Ma'am, thank you so much for being here today. It's our privilege to have you on the panel. We also have with us Mr. Rampal Tiwari, who is the principal of the Rise and Shine Convent School in Dhamdadur. Mr. Tiwari holds a BSc and an MSc in Mathematics and a BEd. He has been the principal in the Rise and Shine Convent School since 1st of March 2019. In the last 2 years of his career as a principal, he has learned all the school administrative functions and continues to practice his teaching of mathematics and physics for the 12th standard. Sir, thank you so much for making the time and being here with us today. We also have with us Mr. Subnam Sharma, who is the principal of the DDI school in Amritsar. Mr. Sharma comes with 25 years of vast experience of teaching English and science till secondary level and 15 years of teaching English at senior secondary level in the capacity of head of department with best board results. She has created proficient language development strategies and plans to meet individual needs. She holds a BSc Medical, an MA in English, a BEd and an MEd. She has been awarded for Best Guide by Children National Science Congress, and Science Models of Our School Children got selected at CBSE national level. Ma'am, thank you so much for being here today and making time for this discussion. I will now stop my share. I would request all of you to please switch on your cameras so that the audience can see all of us. Once again, thank you so much for being here today. It's our privilege to have all of
Thank you.
Let me talk to you first, my first question. When you look at school education as a concept, it's supposed to be universal, inclusive, uniform, and yet
Your voice is cracking. Shubhayu, we can't hear you. Hello? Hello, I can't hear you.
Sorry, ma'am, my apologies. Yeah. That was a connectivity issue at my end.
Right.
Ma'am, my question was that in school education system, which is supposed to be inclusive, uniform, universal, we have a system prevalent as rankings, which again is discriminatory by definition. Ma'am, do you think rankings are beneficial? Do they help? Do they harm? What is your personal take on rankings?
Personally speaking, I don't believe in ranking. And ranking has, in fact, never been part of the system in any of the schools that I've taught in this long career of mine. And the main reason probably is because ranking sometimes really can discriminate, and it can also be very detrimental to those who do not, you know, get ranked the way they wish to get ranked or the way their parents wish want them to be ranked. So ranking definitely doesn't have too many advantages. So, I mean, whether it is in a classroom or whether you're talking about ranking schools or colleges or whatever, I don't believe that ranking in any way promotes any kind of learning. If at all, it might bring in a lot of malpractices, because, you know, to achieve a certain rank, as Mr. Barrett mentioned also, that maybe some of the schools are manipulating these ranks. So yes, because sometimes under pressure, there can be some malpractices in order to achieve that rank. So it doesn't, you know, there's a lot of talk that goes on that ranking promotes competition. But why should a child compete with another to excel? Why doesn't the child compete with himself or herself? You know, this is what I think we need to teach children, that the competition lies within yourself, that you need to better your own achievements every time you perform, whether you're performing in class on a regular basis, whether you're doing your classwork or your homework, or whether you're doing a test. Why should it be that you want to know what is the highest mark in the class? You know, it's a very funny situation, because suppose there is a child who's got the first rank and has got only 6 out of 10. Goes home and tells his parents very proudly, I've got the first rank. And the mother asks him, what marks did you get? And he says, well, I got a 6 on 10. And she says, 6 on 10. And he says, yes, but that's the first mark. I got the first mark. So you see, this is the kind of false pride that we're giving children. And also we, you know, this child who got a 6 on 10 could very well probably be capable of getting a 9 on 10 if he's pushed towards that, but at his own pace and if he really can do it. So personally speaking, I definitely don't think that ranking encourages anything that is, you know, that is really beneficial for children to grow, or for anyone for that matter to grow. Yes, I think, and if you're talking in terms of school rankings, I feel there's no need to really rank or compare, because how do you compare apples to oranges, you know, because schools are of different kinds. Each school has its own unique, distinct character. And I think what needs to be done is an exposure to be given to this unique characteristic of a school. Because a person who wants to send his child to a Ramakrishna Mission school would look at those characteristics, whereas a person who wants to send his child to a Doon school or a Vellum Girls will look at different kind of characteristics. You see, so I don't really understand why should we be ranking schools under the same parameter, or for that matter, rank anybody at all under certain similar parameters. That's my take on ranking.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So we have one vote cast against. So Mr. Sharma, if I may come to you next. Ma'am, your personal take on rankings, school rankings, if I may be more specific.
I think my personal take on this is, as ma'am Brinda is saying, that there shouldn't be any comparison. There should not be any equation of comparison. But if you talk of education system, I have a stand on that yes, education system must be ranked. Like international criteria of OECD is there, that PISA. And India is yet to enter into that system in 2022. It has been postponed. So we need to see that where our education system is going. just comparing the school by virtue of having good infrastructure, you know, this is service industry, I believe it. But as ma'am is saying that there cannot be any parameter to compare the school, as if, you know, a child gets 6 out of 6 on 10 and he is first, maybe the, you know, silly thing to mention over here, maybe a kind of comparison that there were two children only in the race. One was the first and one was the last, right? So it is up to how the judgment is done. But I truly believe that yes, there must be some kind of scrutiny of the quality of education being delivered, because I have the biggest concern over here. I believe that instead of ranking, which is more commercial and sounds very, you know, you have to digest it with a little pinch of salt. But I believe that accreditation is better than ranking. CBSE has, you know, a manual on accreditation, and there are multiple things, multiple parameters, multiple, you know, metrics have been laid on which the judgment is there. It's not only a learning outcome, it's not only on teacher quality, it's not only, parent involvement, the social contribution, the community involvement, the outcomes. It is touching upon everything, but it has been put in the cold storage somewhere. I think these things have to be revived. And more or less, if we come to NEP, NEP 2020 is talking about one school ranking in a geographical area. Then again, I go back to Mr. Philip and Mr. Brinda, ma'am, sorry. Such elite, versed people with the education system, having vast experience and insightful minds, they are aware of the fact that ranking can never be impartial. You know, there will be certain influences, there will be certain, you know, it will become, you know, whether a 5-star school or a 2-star school or 3-star school, it should be some, you know, criteria based. I think ranking should not be the term. It should be accreditation, to my mind. But yes, I believe that there must be standardization of education across India, and some thrust must be put on this area to improve the education standards of the school and deliverables of a school. There must be a commitment of a management, whosoever is running an institution. You cannot earn money and pocket it for, you know, having facilities. I can give you one example that, you know, a very good school has come up, I won't name, and they have put up a chandelier of 20 lakh in the reception area. That is not the criteria to judge. The criteria is, you know, very vast. It is very complex, and there must be judgment, but judgment should be very fair. It should be, you know, very sensitively and very scrutinized and very, you know, well-versed people, those who know how the accreditation process takes place, how the ranking takes place. By word of mouth, you know, here in North, what I believe in Punjab, people are well, you know, they're quite well off. And whichever school is having very good infrastructure, by word of mouth, people say, this school is a good school. They carry a tag. So this tagging has to go away. You know, rating and ranking are good things, but good schools for good to generate good citizens and good people should be the bottom line. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. Mr. Tiwari, I'll come to you next. Sir, I'm going to, ask you a very technical question, and that's purely because you teach maths at a class 12 standard.
Okay. Good evening, sir.
So I
listen the thoughts of the... Yes, mic is on, sir.
Yes, sir.
Because... Are you able to?
Yes. Yes, sir, I can hear you.
I listen. Yes, yes, sir. Thank you. Good evening, sir. All the panelists. Mm-hmm. I listen the thoughtful message of Dr. Phillips, Binda madam, and Sabnam Sharma madam about the ranking of the school. I, most of the extent, agreed with them, but I found this concept why comes in the mind of parents, that they take the decision for admitting his or her ward in the school. Anyway, they are comparing this school is suitable for his standard, for his money, and what is fit for his desiredness. And in this way, number of ways they are comparing that school, which school is very suitable for his or her board. Ranking may not define. Actually, ranking is not defined. Because there are different parameters and it may be manipulated, just like as Binda Madam was saying also. But ranking word, just believe that objective quality of the institution. What the objective quality have institutions? That is ranking. In that way, parents take judgment. And one thing also observe that when a pass out student behave in the social, that his behavior also affect the ranking of the institution. Ki which teachers you have taught, which is from which school you have passed out. If his or her social behavior is not acceptable to the society, that the ranking of the school diminished in the mind of the parent. Sometimes most of depends on the mind of the parents. Ranking sometimes depends in price structure. Yes. Not only the quality of education, infrastructure, surrounding, campus, facilities, safety, just like as what kind of safety, convenience facility. All are the parameters which are deciding the parents for choosing the school. In government scenario, ranking is that not a number of how many number of student get success in the 90% student. This in this way, and how many student crack from this school, very toughest competition like as IIT, JEE, that school is ranked, depends on the ranking. This is the government parameters like this. How many students are success in very CAT, SAT, such types of competition. And this fact, this result also depends the ranking. But anyway, in my scenario, ranking depends on the personal to personal, just like as a parents behavior. Thank you, sir. Okay.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. I will just take one of the questions that we have that has come from the attendees. The question asks, do you think that best ranking schools produce best students always? I think it's a very interesting and quite a loaded question. Mrs. Ghosh, if I may come to you first with this question.
A direct answer would be, it's definitely, the answer cannot be yes. I don't think that, you know, those schools which are ranked one by whichever organization attract the best of the students because they are ranked one. Or even if you look at it the other way, there is no proof that those schools which are ranked number one are the best result producing, or they produce the best students, right? So there's, I don't think that's a fair parameter also. Okay, I mean, to think that or to assume that those schools which are ranked first will produce the best students or attract the best students. Maybe they might attract students depending upon what do they charge and things like that. Yes, of course. But I don't know. I don't think that they would produce the best students. Definitely not. I think, again, coming back to what I said, the students would probably choose a school not depending upon the rank, but depending upon what is it that the school would give them. I think it's a very personal choice. So if there is a way in which the cataloging is done and the schools are, they talk about what they offer, that would probably help better than really talking about some third party ranking you, right? And, you know, there's always this thing about fairness, unfairness and things like that, yeah. Also, I don't know whether we should even think about whom do you categorize as a good student? That's another question. Right. In India, the perception, unfortunately, is about those who qualify for entry into IIT or into IIM. Why not entry into an art course? All right. Why not entry into NID? So why aren't those students also topmost students? You know, so I think the whole thing, it is the perspective has to change about what we call top and what we don't.
Mr. Sharma, I guess you agree because I can see you nodding furiously when Mrs. Ghosh was talking. 100%
with Bindra, ma'am. Whatever she's saying, that what is the criteria of judgment? I may sound, little different in this, as I believe that education is, the basic philosophy is education of body, mind and soul. You know, someone may be academically excelling IAS or, maybe having, but what in the personal take? What kind of person he or she is? Yes, but there can be other side of the story. If someone is looking forward to some organization where he or she wants that my objective is to get the academic training in a particular field, then it can be that, yes, you are going in a particular school where your objective is to achieve it. You want to a school to go to a school which is excelling in sports and other lots of things, and you know that these facilities are there, then you may underline those and find your opinion on them. That I can undertake as a but otherwise I believe that good students happen to good schools, not good schools are there for all the children.
And Mr. Roy, if I may add, this ranking, the business of ranking schools has probably come about, let's say, about 20 years ago, maybe, before that. I've been in this field for almost over 40 years now. And we didn't have to, advertise schools by saying ranked so-and-so and ranked first. Or, but then there was a perception that this school is a school which offers this kind of a curriculum, or if students go into, these are the kind of students who will go into the school and so on and so forth. So it is not that Dhoon School was not known then. Okay. I mean, it didn't require a ranking to let the world know what that school is all about. So my entire take on ranking is that ranking is something which is now, it is more because schools are also competing with each other. I think Shabna mentioned about the chandelier. They're competing with each other who can give better infrastructure and better air conditioning and better technological facility, etc. So are we going to rank schools on that? Is that what schooling is all about? Or are we looking at schooling as shaping minds, young minds, and giving them a scope to train their brain as well as their body? This is the question that we need to ask. And are rankings being done according to that? Because ranking is being done on all these several parameters of infrastructure, of technological support, and you name it, and they have it over there. So this is something that I feel that, yes, it probably exposes all that is available in the country, and it also tells us that what is what. That's about it.
True, ma'am.
I think this raises a very interesting point that Bharat sir earlier on referred to the SEAT cricket ratings. I used to work with sports data. So the system was simple. You can judge the effectiveness of a cricketer or a footballer by his ability to score runs or her ability to score a goal. and that becomes your dependent variable, which is a function of independent variables, which could be, you know, minutes played, number of passes, kind of stroke play, etc. And then you kind of frame an index equation saying that this dependent variable depends on so and so independent variables. What I'm understanding here is one of the major gaps in the ranking system that exists is our dependent variable is not very well defined, because as you said, who's the best student? Is it just scores? Is it better college applications? Or is it just better human beings? And if so, how do you quantify that?
Absolutely. I think history has proved it over and over again that, you know, there are many children who probably didn't do so well in school, but they're doing fantastically in life. Yes. Okay, they're great success stories. So who's to say what is going to happen?
Albert Einstein.
No, even in out of day to day, we don't have to go into those famous characters. But if you look around you, you find samples of such children everywhere. And there are people who've gone into, you know, pressurized by parents and teachers and gone into IIT and or any other of these, you know, institutions through the competitive examinations and have been miserable there and then chosen a different path altogether, wanted to do something which is different. Somebody wants to just come and get back into the field and grow potatoes because that gives him a sense of satisfaction, and why not? Right. So I think what we consider important or what we consider as achievement is something that we need to be very clear about. And when we are ranking, then we are ranking according to this common perception of what is important and why should, you know, why should a particular organization be ranked as one or two or four or five, right? So this is where I think there's a lot of, and they all shape public opinion. So all this ranking business is an effort to shape how parents view your school. So, you know, when they come for admission, they say, oh, if I ask them, why have you chosen my school? A lot of them say, oh, you've been ranked first or second. And my next question is, so what do you understand by that? You know, which is, what are you looking for and what do you understand by this ranking? So this is something which is important for all of us also to understand. I'm not trying to say at all that, you know, I suspect the ranking schemes or any of these organizations or anything, but my personal opinion is that in order to know what kind of school you want to send your child to, you need to know about the school and what it offers. And you look at the alumni of the school, I think that's a very good, exposure to what the school is all about. I think that should really suffice rather than go by these rankings. But yes, of course, in many ways, rankings help schools. And since a lot of the schools are, a school is a business today and parents are clients. So there you are. The ranking helps in that way.
Mr. Tiwari, if I may come to you. Am I audible? Mr. Tiwari, if you're there.
His mic is on mute. Mr. Tiwari, your mic is on mute.
I am. Absolutely agree with Binda Bose, madam. About the ranking, and what the madam said, just like as the, this is depends on person to person and a different prospect of the parents. But I found and every, just like one parent asked, the every good ranking school produces very good child. This is not like this. Okay, why? It depends on the personal to person and learner to learner and thinker to thinker, which school is very good or less, not good. Person to person, individual to individual, school by school, it depends on very varied things. We cannot relate which one is a fixed parameter by which this school is a very good. In my prospect. But that things is not seen, that intelligence, ranking, something which are indulged in the mind, which cannot be just a diagnosis by this criteria, this school is good. And so in this way, I am just give light to message of all the audience ranking, just like as a, by this criteria, you are taking admission in the school, but you think main motto of the school means just like as school nature is just how you are producing the intelligence, how you are developing the student socially fit for the country, their behavior, ethics, moral values should be fit for our country. Such types of moral things should also develop in the school. And in this way, sometimes parent also thinking, here in this school, their moral values are good, that my child will respect his family or nation. Okay, sir. Sufficient. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, sir.
Thank you. Ma'am, if I may come back to you, I understand that you as educators, you have such huge experience in the school education system, and you know that rankings are not something that you value terribly. Look at it from the parents' lens. The student is not the initial point of decision, right? It's pretty much the parent who look at certain parameters, say that this is the school that I want to send my child to.
Yeah.
And there seems to be this slight bit of prestige or brag value attached to saying that, okay,
yeah,
I got my son or daughter into the rank one school. How do you change this mindset? Because it's as much a demand side problem as a supply side problem.
Yeah, absolutely. I really don't know whether you can really change this, because today, it, like I mentioned a little while ago, that it is a world today where it's like a business. And yes, of course, a parent has to make a decision. So, you know, for him or for her, what is seeable and what is apparent, you know, and that is what helps that person to kind of make a decision. And they're making a decision with their children while the children are in kindergarten, and they have, you know, like 12 years ahead of them. But they're looking at the school then and then making a decision. But I suppose, yes, that's why I said that exposure is necessary. But then when you rank them, I don't know whether ranking is really necessary there. Because, but yes, that is, there should be a cataloging. I like that. This was said by Mr. Barrett, that if there is a catalog which kind of tells or lists the kind of schools that are available in the vicinity and what is it known for, that would definitely help. You know, then the parent would also be able to see. And I think it is also very important to know what is the end result, and where do these children go from the school, the alumni, and that is also important. And sometimes, yes, it becomes when there is this ranking system or when there is something, a survey that is done and the result of the survey is produced, then there is an exposure to the parents that, okay, there is a school like this available and maybe I could go in and have a look at this school. So a parent might want to then come and look at it. So maybe it serves that small purpose.
Ma'am, I can't help but think that the American system, which kind of mandates you to study in a local school.
Yes.
And the school that you go to is pretty much a function of the locality that you're a part of. Yeah. It kind of levels the playing field, so to say. Do you think that's a better system?
Undoubtedly so, because there's uniformity in the system. They're able to do that because, whether it is in America or even in England, Ofsted is so, they have standards that are set and every school is supposed to follow that. So if you look at our country with the NEP coming in, if the NEP is really implemented in word and spirit, I see this happening even in our country, where if schools have a uniform kind of a syllabus, I'm not talking about infrastructure over here, but I'm talking about what is to be given to the children in terms of a curriculum in the school, then I think we could arrive at a situation like this. But then in our country, there's a huge, you know, there's a huge difference between economically speaking, and therefore again the choice becomes difficult for parents. So there are schools and schools and schools, and that's exactly the only advantage of this is that the parent has a choice. You know, depending on what he or she wants, he can make a choice. Depending on the capacity of spending, the parent can make a choice also. So I think it'll take a long time for us to reach where they've reached. But with the NEP coming in, at least we can hope that there would be uniformity in the design of curriculum and what we offer to the children.
No, I think the NEP is a brilliant document.
It's a brilliant document. And if it is really followed in word and spirit, then yes, we really have a lot of hope.
I think the second part, in spirit, is more important to me.
Yes. Yes.
Rather than, you know, aiming for check boxes.
Absolutely. Yeah. Otherwise, it'll go the way the, you know, CCE went. CCE went, you know, it was such a beautiful system. But it wasn't explained thoroughly to people, and stakeholders didn't really understand it. And it started being done only for the, on paper, without really understanding what it is all about. That should definitely not be the case.
Mr. Sharma, if I may come to you with, in terms of parents' perceptions, the state that you're based out of, Punjab, how much of importance do parents assign to these rankings, or is it more equitable?
No, it's not at all equitable, in particularly the region I come from, because, you know, it is a wealth-driven kind of portion of our country. And here the people are carried away. In the city, we have, you know, in 3 kilometer of circumference, if there are 4-5 schools, they know a school particularly, and they'll be coming 25 kilometers away to that school, knowing the fact that so-and-so has studied in this school and he comes from a good family. So it is a brand, you know, they blindly follow. So that school, infrastructure wise, if you see, is not very good, or this school, that school comparison is there. They don't look into infrastructure. They don't look into the facilities. They don't have any kind of, you know, parameter to judge the ranking, if I may say. It is only blindfoldedly following a legacy in the family that they know this. There are 3-4 schools in one city, which are, you know, the big shots, and all the children are going there. So in north, the situation, particularly in Punjab, and where, you know, this more of, you know, the people are of the mind that business community is leading. So commercially aspect, the commercial aspect is associated with the school branding. And as Brinda ma'am was saying, that there can be choice if more schools are there. The choice of the parent is also a question over here. They don't want to opt for any other school which may be doing good, but it is, if you are costing more, that means you are delivering better, which is not the fact. So this is a hard, you know, hitting story of this my region.
Wow. We hear about price value perception in marketing.
Yes, it is there. Yeah. It is there.
Very interesting to know that, how that translates to school decisions. I'll come to the last question that I had. I cannot see Mr. Tiwari on his camera. Sir, I hope you're there. My last question pertains to technology, right? Technology, while in the last 1 year, has kind of made it apparent that there is a huge digital divide. There's a large part of the country that does not have access to devices or networks that will give them online education. At the same time, up to a large extent, it has also been the leveler that a lot of students from different kinds of schools have gotten exposed to the same kind of teaching and the same kind of educators thanks to the online medium. Do you think as online education becomes more, you know, popular and common, it'll take away this need for rankings? Mr. Sharma, if I may ask you this first.
I don't think so. I contradict here because, you know, no doubt it has become necessary to, you know, have this parallel kind of education in blended form, which is need of the hour also. Otherwise, we couldn't have, you know, we might have had broken all the channels to impart education or connect to our children had there not been any, you know, technology accessibilities to commoners and all the schools and teachers and, you know, during this COVID time. And for other things also, apart from academic deliverance of on the part of the school, we were contacting children and, you know, we were seeing them face to face. It was just, you know, a blessing from technology. But as your question, I have missed certain part. I think you want to ask that, can we do away with this? I don't think we should ever do away from technology.
No, ma'am. I was asking that would the, if technology becomes kind of encompassing and more people are using the same kind of technology, would it take away the need for rankings? Because then you're not limited to a particular school. It's not a exclusive choice, so to say.
I see the scenario differently because many parents in India, economic background of the parents vary. There are people, those who are having meager means of earning. They don't have, you know, fancy or Android or iPhones or, you know, the laptops and all. But there are many things, there are many apps which are not compatible to those kinds of simple tools and means they have. So here I have a hiccup that may not be. So ranking, to my mind, technology cannot, it may add a factor to the ranking, but it will not be the sole criteria to judge a school on the basis of technological aspects or, you know, the linkages or the privileges it has.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Mr. Tiwari, if you're there, because I can't see you on your camera. Sir, can you hear me?
Okay. Are you, I'm audible, sir? I'm audible, sir?
Yes, sir, we can hear you. We cannot see you.
Okay. Sir, I think audio visual tools, electronic tools, make the very...
I think sir got disconnected. Could be a network issue at his end. Sir, are you there?
Hello,
sir.
Sir,
we lost you for a second.
Okay. Just I am finishing this question. Means audio visual tools make the understanding of a student very easy. So just like as whenever picturize the concept,
I think sir has a bit of a network issue. His audio is dodging in and out. We'll definitely get back to him. Mrs. Ghosh, if I may come to you, talking of the NEP, if you are talking about creating school clusters, one, you know, so-called big school with other schools associated with it.
Oh.
Okay, sorry.
Yes. Just like, I am just like to complete this question, Sam.
Yes, sir, please.
Please, audio visual tools which are used in the system of education that make the understanding of the child very good. Because whenever picturize the concept, that concept will be fit in the mind of a student. And in this way, this is very important. And whether parents should be bear the expenses or government should be bear, but this is very good for the student in my
prospect. That tools is very fit because picturization concept is very good, and that is a intelligence or understanding of the child makes it perfect. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Mrs. Ghosh, I'll just come back to that point where if you're creating a cluster of schools and one big school is kind of heading up a cluster, there are other schools which are shadowing that school or associated with that school, and they're all connected technologically, so that a very experienced expert educator now does not teach just one class, but a huge catchment of students. Do you think that kind of technological use might level it a little bit, make this
I think that's in fact an ideal situation, but I don't really know whether we are aiming at that at all, because given the fact that even if you have clusters of school, each school, I foresee that the schools are again going to be competing to show that, you know, we are better than you, kind of a thing. So unless there is a particular mandate and a protocol that has been drawn out and given to these clusters of schools, I really doubt whether that will help. But yes, if technologically everybody is connected, which even today we are, I mean, there are many many schemes. If you are familiar with what the British Council does, you can actually connect with schools while your regular class is going on abroad with schools and classrooms abroad. So I think in that way, technology is going to be a big boon. And if there are schools, the idea of that the NEP proposes a cluster is to share best practices and to make whatever is available in one school to share it with another school. So if that is the motive, and if it is really done again in word and spirit, then it's going to be a great thing. It definitely, you know, so many children are going to benefit by the quality of one particular teacher in a particular field. Okay, so it could be that a particular school has a fantastic math department, and technologically that department can share all its best practices with the others. It's a very good system. So if that is really brought about, yes, it's going to be a great advantage to all schools. But every school has got to accept it and understand that, you know, we are here to help each other grow. There the competition and the ranking is not going to help, because then the school which is ranked first will say, oh my God, if you learn this from me, then you are going to come closer to me in the rank. So I don't know whether if that is what you were trying to ask.
Yes, ma'am, that was pretty much it. But as we have seen across any industry, the more we move away from competition and more towards collaboration, I think it's always for the greater good.
It's definitely the best thing that can happen if you can collaborate, which is the idea behind creating certain, you know, all these clusters. Even now, the CBSE schools do have their clusters. And the idea behind it is to see how one school can help the other. But honestly speaking, not much is happening there also, because again, each school is so caught up in their own systems and trying to do things for themselves that it's rarely that a school reaches out to another and helps another school. You know, it's practically also sometimes it's not possible to do that. But yes, there can be a lot of exchanges that can happen between schools. And I've done this kind of a thing while I was in heading a school in Ahmedabad, and we had collaborations with other schools, you know, children spending time on exchange programs within the local schools. And I think that helps a lot. So then there is no sense of, oh, if that child comes to my school, or if you don't think in terms of, oh, if they go to that school, will they leave my school and go to that school? So that comfort level and that confidence has to be within you, that whether my child goes to XYZ school, he's going to come back and say, no, that school has very good things, but this is my school and I'm proud of this school. I think that's the sense that we need to create. So even when it comes to sharing technology, I think if we can do that, you know, confidently say that, yes, I'm ready to share, and why not?
Wonderful, ma'am. A year ago, we could not have imagined doing so much of studies online. We could not have imagined this webinar.
No, not
online.
At all. No, I think this, to me, it's come in many ways, certain aspects of online teaching have come as a boon. And as an administrator, as a school principal, I think this online thing is wonderful because it has given me an opportunity to look into so many classrooms far more than I could do physically.
Physically.
Right? Yeah, so that's one thing. Secondly, I think also for children, for some sections of children, it has been very good. I would definitely say that for children with learning disabilities, this online mode, for some of them, it has proved to be a boon. And for some children who have other issues, you know, other psychological issues and acceptability issues and all, this online medium has helped them to become more confident and they are blossoming. So in many ways it's come. And teachers have done a wonderful job. The way they have, you know, got adjusted to this and the way they are using technology is really beautiful. I mean, I have learned so much. So I think it's good.
Wonderful, ma'am. We would have loved to continue this longer,
yes,
but because of paucity of time, we'll have to cut this short. Well, once again, thank you so much for making the time to be part of this panel today. I will leave Auchin to do the formal vote of thanks, but this has been a wonderful, wonderful discussion for me. Auchin, you will have quite a bit to thank for, so take it away.
I think really a great session we had and some very thought-provoking discussion, must appreciate. Bharat sir, thank you so much for your perspective and for giving us a great start as always. And I think one thing that you pointed out, sir, I completely agree with you with regard to student happiness and how that is so important as a factor. And which, you know, very often is not captured in this entire ranking exercise. So trying to plot it in an Excel sheet. So really, this kind of qualitative factor, which is so, so important. Again, Britha ma'am, I really thank you. Thank you for your time and for your deliberation. Indeed, some very, very good points you highlighted, ma'am, which I'm sure are takeaways for our esteemed audience today that we have here. Wonderful. I think two things really stays with me. One is, I think you very, very nicely articulated, very beautifully articulated the concept of shaping of young minds and what school is all about, you know, the more holistic view of schooling and of education. And also the fact, the importance of alumni, instead of looking at rankings, I think very practical advice for parents as well, that instead of looking at ranking, why don't we really look at what the school has actually produced, the alumni and their contribution to the society. And also, I think the concept of cataloging that Bharat also touched upon, I think very practical and balanced view. I must appreciate, ma'am.
Thank you
so much. Shabna, ma'am, again, I think two very important takeaways from your deliberation. First and foremost, I think you touched upon a very, very, very important aspect that Not only about scholastic or academic outcomes, but what kind of person, as a human being, what kind of human beings, what kind of person is the school producing? I think that is very, very important with regard to their contribution as members of the civil society. And also the fact that with regard to your views, that yes, some kind of yardstick, evaluation, scrutiny, assessment is needed. Maybe something not as apparent as ranking, but yes, I agree with you. That, of course, because whenever there is some kind of evaluation, that also helps us in terms of self-introspection, in terms of trying to be better, looking at what the best practices in industry are, and trying to raise the bar, which is all fair. I think it only adds value to that. So I think thank you, ma'am, for your deliberation. Some very good points. Thank you for your time as well. Tiwari, sir, I think... two very good points, sir, that I think first point that you made, again, very, very important in line with what I was just saying a short while back. A student's behavior in the society, someone who has passed out of the school, how he or she conducts himself or herself in public domain, that really is very, very important. That leaves a kind of indelible impression in the mind of parents, and not only parents, I'll say all stakeholders of the society, of the educational ecosystem. how an ex-alumni of the school or a current student of the school, how he or she conducts himself or herself in a public forum, be it in a social gathering, be it in a market. I think that is the best testimony, really. It's the litmus test, I must say. So I think you have been very, very candid and categoric with regard to this. And second, again, I think you highlighted the fact that aspects like value, behavior, ethics are so important, which, of course, I'm sure all of us here completely agree with you on that. All esteemed educators in this forum, all of us completely agree with you on that, that yes, of course, it's not only a question of academic outcomes, but factors like software aspects, you know, which are the ultimate objectives of education with regard to our value system, ethics and behavior. And also, I think, yes, you're completely right, sir, that parameters vary. Parameters vary from person to person. So like every parent, every, you know, might be having an individual outlook towards what he or she looks at. And this is something I think Shabnam ma'am also mentioned, that someone looking at sporting facilities, someone else might have some other objectives, etc. That is all fair. So I think great, very, very nice discussion we had. One thing I would just like to add here, as listening very patiently to the discussion, one single point with regard to system in Western countries, with regard to people choosing school or people being allocated school, I'll not say there's a choice, much of a choice, public school especially, and in context of where they stay. Now, 2 points I would like to add. A, this is with regard to public school system of a parallel private schools exist in all Western countries where students who can afford to pay can choose a school and cover the distance. Second, I think another thing which is very important is there again, the question of affordability comes in an indirect way, because areas where the most sought after schools are based, those are the most expensive areas. You know, areas where property prices are the highest, areas where municipal taxes are the highest. So I don't know whether school rankings push the property prices up, or how does it work the other way around. But that's a practical challenge. So I think these are some great issues that I want to discuss. And I thank all of you for your time. I thank members of the esteemed audience as well for your time. Thank you. Take care and goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.